And coverage of the events commemorating D-Day begins now on BBC One, as the heads of state of the wartime allies and Normandy veterans gather at Portsmouth to remember the embarkation of the D-Day Armada.
The hour of our greatest effort and action is approaching. We march with valiant allies who count on us as we count on them. The flashing eyes of all our soldiers, sailors and airmen must be fixed upon the enemy on their front. And when the signal is given, the whole circle of avenging nations will hurl themselves upon the foe.
Almost 5 years, ever since September 1939, the European continent had been dominated by the totalitarian Nazi regime of Adolf Hitler's Germany. During that time, it had provoked the bloodiest war in history. It developed a policy of racial extermination, culminating in the Holocaust, the destruction of the Jews. It invented and perfected mass extermination camps, suppressed free speech and thought, and destroyed democratic institutions. It was universally seen as a regime of evil. General Eisenhower, the Supreme Allied Commander, called the liberation of occupied France that began on D-Day a great crusade. Well, here in Aramanche, as you can see, we have got anniversary weather. This must have been pretty like what it was like 50 years ago. Very difficult, not very good. Because 50 years ago this weekend, the greatest armada ever assembled set sail to free Europe from tyranny. They landed on D-Day, June the 6th, 1944. If there is a just war, this was surely it. If there was a just battle, this was surely it too. And 50 years on, the heads of state of the 14 nations involved in the liberation of Europe are gathering to commemorate a military campaign that changed the face of the century. In the next 2.5 days, on both sides of the Channel, these heads of government will honor the occasion in a series of ceremonies, religious services, and commemorations of key moments in the D-Day landings. Each event has its own drama, but each event, too, pays tribute to those who lost their lives in a battle whose success meant that the lives of millions of others were saved. So this weekend commemorates, recognizes, and salutes those who lost their lives in the achievement of victory. In half an hour or so, massed bands from four nations will beat retreat in the grounds of HMS Excellence at Portsmouth, in front of Her Majesty, Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, the Prime Minister, and some 5,000 Normandy veterans. This event will symbolize the moment 50 years ago when the decision to go ahead with Operation Overlord had been taken and the embarkation began. And then tomorrow morning, a congregation of around 75,000 will gather here, South Sea Common in Portsmouth, for a drumhead service. Those taking part will represent the nations involved in the maritime part of D-Day, Operation Neptune, Channel crossing of a fleet of almost 6,000 vessels which allowed the landings to take place. That'll be followed by a review of a quite extraordinary gathering of ships. Heads of state on board the Royal Yacht Britannia, they'll sail by 81 vessels from 14 nations, and the giant of these is the USS George Washington, an aircraft carrier, the largest warship in the world, and the official home this weekend of President Clinton. Tomorrow, the commemoration of the landings themselves begins, starting with the all-important paratroop landings on this field outside Ronville. Now, that's going to depend very much on the weather. And the glider assault on the bridge over the Caen Canal, that's the famous Pegasus Bridge. This is the new one you can see here. It replaced the old historic bridge just a few weeks ago. And then we move on Monday to the memorial services. They'll take place at many of the main war cemeteries, with the Queen and President Mitterrand leading the congregation at the largest of the British ones here at Bayeux. while later in the day, back here at Aramanche, site of the world's most famous artificial harbour, the Mulberry, you can see a bit of it there in the middle of your picture, the Queen will take a march past of some 7,000 British Normandy veterans on the beach. The tide will, of course, be out by then, but that's where it's going to take place, by that caisson. All of these events take place on the sites where the great actions of D-Day occurred. They also represent larger parts of those events and what came after, because D-Day was itself the first day of the Normandy campaign, the most important, of course, and that campaign was itself the first stage in the destruction of Nazi power. Well, throughout the weekend, I've got Colonel Mike Dewar here with me to set these events in their broader context, to remind you or tell you for the first time why D-Day mattered so much and why it's being so appropriately commemorated. There's going to be a lot of detail about D-Day, Mike. That's why we've got to keep the broader context, the overall picture, in some sort of perspective, isn't it?
Absolutely, John, which I think is why it might be a good idea if I start by painting the broader picture, what was going on in the rest of Europe before D-Day.
Please do that.
Although Nazi domination of Europe had remained unchallenged in 1940 and 1941, the Russians had started to fight back, first at Stalingrad and then in some of the great tank battles on the Eastern Front. And the Western Allies had won an important victory in North Africa and then successfully invaded Sicily and Italy. So by May 1944, Germany was under severe pressure on its Eastern Front, where it had committed no less than 200 divisions in an attempt to stop the Russian advance westwards. It had also been forced to increase the number of divisions in Italy from 6 in July 1943 to 22 in May 1944, where the Western Allies had already battled their way halfway up the Italian peninsula. As a result, Hitler could only muster 60 divisions for the defense of France. The importance of Russian pressure on the Nazi war machine in this respect can hardly be overestimated. At the same time, however, both from a military and political perspective, it was crucial for the Allies that a second front be opened in the West. The Western Allies faced a formidable task. Of the 60 German divisions in France, the vast majority were in the north, stretched along the Channel and Atlantic coast, manning the so-called Atlantic Wall. These consisted of two elements, the primary infantry divisions stationed on the coast or close to it, and secondly of the armoured or panzer reserve divisions held in some depth, ready to counterattack any Allied toeholds before they could be established. In order to achieve this daunting task, the Western Allies had turned Britain into an enormous military base. Aircraft carrier Britain is a good way of describing it. American troops had been pouring into Britain via West Coast ports since 1943. So that by May 1944, they totaled no less than 1.5 million. The southern coastline was declared a restricted zone to a depth of some 10 miles, and much of Devon, Dorset, Hampshire, and Sussex became one vast armed camp, with the Americans concentrated in the southwest and the British and Canadians in the central south and southeast of the country. By the end of May 1944, the scene was set for the greatest amphibious operation in the history of warfare.
And so it was, all that effort focused on 50 miles of the beaches on both sides of us. That was what was at stake 50 years ago. And the history of the time now matches the ceremonial of today. So let's start the weekend ceremonies by joining Jill Dando in Portsmouth.
Well, weather-wise, it's very similar on this side of the Channel. This is South Sea Common at Portsmouth, which will be the base for the initial events leading up to the main D-Day anniversary on Monday. Many of us will never have seen such a great combination of military might and personnel on the south coast than we'll see here this weekend. We are the lucky ones. Those who gathered here in preparation for the Normandy landings 50 years ago remember another, far larger armada only too well. Then, though, there was little colour and certainly no pomp and no ceremony. Thousands of veterans of the D-Day assault are expected to come here tomorrow to meet old comrades, to pay tribute to friends who died, and by their very presence here to remind us all what their bravery meant for the world. Understandably, spare accommodation here at this stage is very limited, and in a sense it's a case of déjà vu, because 50 years ago 29,000 military personnel had to be billeted in Portsmouth. Hotels, guest houses and even schools were requisitioned. Well, here we are inside the Veterans Centre, where people have been milling around since it opened on Wednesday. Wednesday, incidentally, you may remember, was a gloriously sunny day, but today is certainly the place to come in and get out of the rain. We had gale force winds yesterday and things aren't much better today. Veterans have been told that to regard this as a home from home. There's regular entertainment, get cups of tea and obviously plenty of opportunity to meet old friends. Events are taking place all along the south coast, of course, but tomorrow morning the common here will be packed for the drumhead service to remember those who took part in the seaborne phase of the operation. The Queen and other members of the royal family will be here, along with President Clinton and other heads of state. That'll be followed by the flotilla review out there in the Solent. And this afternoon, there's a garden party at Southwark House, which was General Eisenhower's headquarters. Tonight, the Queen will host an anniversary banquet at Portsmouth Guildhall. This afternoon, all eyes are on one event to symbolise the embarkation of the invasion forces, and for that, we cross to our commentator, Eric Robson.
Well, here at Whale Island, bands from Great Britain and France, from the United States and Canada, will beat retreat. It's a ceremony to mark the close of day that finds its origins in the military life of 300 and more years ago. Some 5,000 veterans have gathered from all over Britain under these grey June skies to hear them. This evening, half a century ago, troops in their hundreds of thousands were huddled by the Channel coast, waiting for what must have seemed to some of them a simple decision: go to somewhere in France. But it was a decision which for months had occupied the thoughts of that group of strong, single-minded men who'd taken the destiny of a free Europe in their hands. The team led by Supreme Commander General Eisenhower.
I assumed command at Schaeff with the best all-round team for which a man could ask. Some had already been working for months in England. Others I brought with me from the Mediterranean.
Eisenhower had picked the best Allied commanders, but could he make such strong characters work as a team?
Every subject he approached, he approached objectively, without any prejudice or passion. A very important point when you're dealing with different officers of different nationalities.
Eisenhower chose Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Tedder as his deputy. Tedder was a great team player, but he also had the strength of character to force air commanders to back Overlord.
There was a strong feeling amongst Royal Air Force officers that Bomber Command should be kept on its strategic job of bombing the industrial centres of Germany. Tedder felt it necessary that Bomber Command should contribute its heavy bombers to the strategy in support of the armed forces invading France. Tedder got his way, and subsequent analysis established that Tedder's strategy did destroy the capacity of the German army to stay in the field. He was a very brilliant man.
Tedder was a great help in handling Montgomery, the brilliant but maverick Allied ground commander who had little regard for Eisenhower.
Montgomery wasn't a very likeable or lovable human being. He was boastful, he was incredibly vain, he was abrasive, ungracious, all those things. But he possessed a quality that a lot of great British military gentlemen didn't: the killer instinct. He had an incredibly sharp analytical approach to battlefield problems.
Monty had no friends. He had competitors. He really did look at you, not as a friend, but are you a competitor with him? Because he would never admit that anyone was as good or effective and intelligent military as he. Vaunting ambition, vaunting self-confidence. Monty, I said, was a great man. I will never join those who criticize or condemn him.
But the final responsibility lay with Eisenhower.
Eisenhower wasn't a battlefield commander in the same class as Bradley, Montgomery, Patton, but he was a great alliance commander, that I think he possessed a greatness of spirit, a generosity of spirit, which enabled him to hold that alliance together, and which made, at a working level, the Anglo-American alliance one of the most remarkable achievements of the Second World War and arguably military history.
Southwark House, 7 miles north of Portsmouth, was where General Eisenhower and Field Marshal Montgomery worked together in the days and the weeks leading up to D-Day. It was here the general made that crucial decision to go. And it's here this afternoon that the first main commemorative event is taking place. It's a rather wet garden party hosted by the Defence Secretary Malcolm Rifkin. Around 500 guests are here, including Her Royal Highness Princess Margaret, Prime Minister John Major, the Foreign Secretary Douglas Hurd, and many veterans of the time. They're all here to remember the planning phase of Operation Overlord, which went on understandably against a background of secrecy. Here we see Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands being introduced to the Lord Lieutenant of Hampshire, Mrs. Mary Fagan, and subsequently to a long line of local dignitaries. That's Captain Ritchie on the right-hand side of Prince Bernhard. There we have the Prime Minister of Canada, Jean Chrétien, his wife Aline also being introduced. A car arriving now, carrying Her Royal Highness Princess Margaret. Guests arrived around an hour and a half ago. As you can see, a lot of rain there, not exactly a garden party as one would have wished for. Princess Margaret being introduced to the Lord Lieutenant.
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Again, what a shame that the sun wasn't shining. It's a beautiful house and beautiful landscape. Malcolm Rifkin, the Defence Secretary, showing Princess Margaret into the map room with Captain Ritchie, who is captain of HMS Dryad, which is now a maritime operations training school. Princess Margaret was just 14 years old when D-Day took place. She's being shown the map, which is 19 feet wide, 15 feet high. And it's the very one that Eisenhower and his men used to plot the manoeuvres in the days and the weeks leading up to D-Day. June the 6th, 1944. Normally, the map is kept behind glass to help preserve it. Commissioned from the toy firm of Chad Valley, it was made and delivered in sections, largely for security reasons. And the story goes that the two carpenters who erected it were kept incommunicado in Southwark until Operation Overlord was well underway. The final action plan remains here, just as it looked half a century ago. But the atmosphere in the map room then was very different from today's.
It's such a hive of activity at the time, you know. There were mostly senior officers buzzing about all over the place.
Nothing had been left undone which could not be done to succeed in Operation Overlord. But there was no trace of any overconfidence.
There were, I imagine, about 15 to 20 of us typing the operation orders for D-Day, where the ships would go, where they would land. Masses, there seemed to be masses of operation orders, drafts cancelled, new orders typed.
The voices, the talk, was always in a calm, quiet key. Never laughing, joking, or anything of that kind. I would have loved to have burst out with a bit of enthusiasm or something, but no. And it was the right way to approach it. Because if we had failed to prepare for what we should have been prepared for, then tens and tens of men, thousands of lives would be lost.
We knew possibly month before that it was going to be round about the early part of June. I think most of us thought it was to be the 5th. Well, it was terribly secret. We don't sort of whisper a word. I mean, it was so secret, I can't tell you. And you didn't feel inclined to.
Southwark House had been chosen as advanced headquarters for D-Day in 1943. And by the time the senior Allied commanders moved here the following year, the momentum of the build-up was unstoppable. The people who worked and planned here then would still recognise the hall and the great staircase now. And outside, the house has changed little since the Allied leaders and their staffs came together in those last vital days and weeks before the liberation. Today, as the School of Maritime Operations, HMS Dryad, it provides warfare training for both naval officers and ratings, and inevitably much of its interior has changed. But 50 years ago today, it was behind this window in the library that General Eisenhower pondered his momentous decision whether to give Operation Overlord the immediate go-ahead or not. Well, today the scene is relaxed and informal. Of course, 50 years ago it couldn't have been more different. There we have the garden party. I'm afraid the guests have beat a retreat to the marquees in the gardens here. Definitely wet weather gear is de rigueur here this afternoon. I see one of the bands due to play here, the Western Band of the Royal Air Force, had in their programme Here's That Rainy Day Feeling. I'm sure that was rather prophetic. Well, once he'd made up his mind, Eisenhower said very calmly, OK, let's go. But that decision depended wholly on the weather, or more crucially, the weather forecast. Even today, it could have an effect on tomorrow's timetable of commemorative events. Now, all was set for an assault on June the 5th, but conditions weren't good, with gale force winds and low cloud in the area. But things looked better for June the 6th. They had to be, because the combination of moon and tides wouldn't be as conducive for a landing until at least a fortnight later. The forecast was a group effort. It took no fewer than six top meteorologists working separately. Two Americans, an Englishman from the Met Office, a Norwegian, and two naval officers.
We all relied on the GPO. We worked separately. We had the same, exactly the same data which came through on teleprinter and was put on large maps for us. Each of us did our own analysis and our own forecast. And then we got together on the telephones, which were, of course, connected to Ike's headquarters. Crunch came at 9 p.m. on Saturday night. We had to make a forecast for the 5th. About 400 or 500 miles to the west of us was a depression that was threatening us, and it was coming up faster than we really expected, and that depression had associated with it a cold front which undoubtedly was going to give us a storm. We all had kittens, of course, in case we'd gone wrong, and we kept on discussing the matter, but we knew that 24 hours later we would have to make another crunch forecast for the 6th.
I was up on deck that afternoon, and I saw a marine landing craft getting at speed round the harbour with a young marine sending a message in semaphore continuously off the stern, like it's waving flags. I knew semaphore, in fact, because I'd been a signals officer at one time, and I was able to translate it, and it simply said, Overlord postponed 24 hours.
What happened after that was that we firmed up overnight on the fact that the weather would be sufficiently decent for the invasion, and we all agreed at 4 p.m. when Eisenhower said, go ahead, okay, we'll go. We all agreed that the weather would be possible.
The Allied fleet was already assembled in readiness for Eisenhower's decision. In harbours from Brixham to Burnham-on-Crouch, from Tilbury to Weymouth, almost 7,000 vessels had gathered. Today, in Portsmouth and its approaches, ships from the UK and Allied navies have come back to pay tribute in grey steel to the crews who put their seamanship to the test, often of destruction, in those weeks of 1944. Among the many vessels riding at anchor or moored here at Portsmouth, from America, there's the carrier George Washington. With her will be the ship that brought hope across the Atlantic in the dark days of war, the Liberty ship. From the Royal Navy, there's HMS Illustrious, and with her will be a flotilla of ships from mine hunters to destroyers and fleet auxiliaries. In June 1944, some 900 merchant ships assembled in ports on the Thames, in the Bristol Channel, and at Grimsby to play their part in Operation Neptune. Today's merchant and passenger fleet will pay their tribute to the merchantmen who went to war, some on their final voyage. Tomorrow, many hundreds of small boats are expected to sail out to join these bigger ships as Her Majesty the Queen, President Clinton, and the leaders of 12 other countries review the fleet at Spithead. Here at Whale Island, we're awaiting the first of our distinguished guests. Secretary of State for Defence, Malcolm Rifkin. On the square, a guard of honour found by the Queen's Colour Squadron, Royal Air Force, and the band of the Royal Corps of Signals. Veterans have gathered from all over Britain. It's been a stormy day for them. But then, as Jill was saying earlier, at least it's historically correct. The weather was like this in June 1944. We await the French national anthem. French Minister of Defence, François Léotard, taking the salute. This is Whale Island. It's a man-made island, made by the convicts who dug out and extended the Portsmouth Harbour Basin. It's a place with a long and complex military history. The first experiments with torpedoes were conducted in the waters around it. The weather here has lashed us since early morning. Arriving in these drier conditions now is the United States Secretary of State, Warren Christopher. Queen's Colour Squadron will come to attention.
Guard of honour! Guard of honour! General salute!
Among the audience you'll have seen there, members of another generation, a younger generation, junior cadets from the United States. We're now joined by the Prime Minister of Canada, Jean Chrétien. What we have in these events to commemorate D-Day is since the Edinburgh summit. Nine members of the British royal family and the heads of state of 14 countries will be in attendance at events here and in northern France. These waters around Portsmouth have provided a safe haven British naval forces since the days of King John in the 13th century. 700 years of the ebb and flow of British history have been acted out here. We wait now here on the square at Whale Island. His Royal Highness, the Grand Duke of Luxembourg. Salute ordered by Guard of Honour Commander Squadron Leader Edward Ady. His Royal Highness the Grand Duke of Luxembourg, of course, led his troops into Luxembourg on the 10th of September 1944 when his country was liberated, now Colonel of the Irish Guards. Here we see the great complex of naval dockyards that stretch away to the south of Whale Island. It's a place that's seen the start of many invasions in those 700 years of naval history. It's always prided itself on being the safe haven on the south coast. And we await Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, the Queen Mother, in the company of the host of this event, the Prime Minister, John Major. an expectant crowd, some of them catching a first glimpse over the back of the stands as Her Majesty makes her way from the wardroom to the royal box. Behind the Queen Mother, Princess Royal, Mrs. Major. Waiting for the photographs that they'll take home and treasure. And the Met Office, on this occasion, as they were 50 years ago, were true to their word. We rang them at about lunchtime when the winds and rain were driving horizontally across this parade ground, and they told us that by 4:30 it wouldn't exactly be bright sunshine, but the rain would cease. We have missed, but the rain has gone. But the veterans here who are waiting for their first glimpse of Her Majesty are people with a stiff upper lip. They sat here through the storm. They weren't prepared to give up their seats, waiting for this beat retreat. So many people with so many private memories on these occasions. As you might expect, the small delay is because Her Majesty loves talking to the people along the way. Scott Oneida, Edward Adey, brings the Guard of Honour to attention. As Her Majesty, accompanied by Group Captain Niall Irving, makes her way to the Royal Box. You'll have heard that Her Majesty has arrived. Guard of the Queen's Colour Squadron reordered. They're custodians, of course, of the Queen's Colour of the Royal Air Force in the UK, a colour presented last year at RAF Marham. colour with its escort will return to its place in the line in preparation for the march off. And as they prepare to march away, let me tell you that we will see the men of the Queen's Colour Squadron later in the beat retreat programme. And as the band of the Royal Corps of Signals marches away, we await the first of our visiting bands, the band representing France. And perhaps I should explain what this beat retreat is about. It's nothing to do with withdrawal in the face of defeat. It actually finds its origins in the days of gracious warfare, where at the end of day, the two armies would disengage to their own camps and return to the field the morrow. It later became used to the beat of drum in garrisons around the world, as the signal would be given that the gates were to be closed for the night. Troops outside the garrison had to return to safety. It's similar to tattoo, which comes from the Dutch phrase tapto, which actually means the shutting off of the taps. It actually was the sign to close the alehouses and bring soldiers and sailors back to garrison or ship. Marching on now from France, the band of the Légion de Gendarmerie Mobile d'Île-de-France, with the Marche Lorraine, composed by Louis Gann, who for many years was musical director of the casino at Monte Carlo. Major Gonchier brings the band to a halt. Conductor Michel Moisson takes the applause as they prepare to play Villa Parade. This band that was formed in 1934 provides a unique link between national and local forces in France. They now play the theme of the film 633 Squadron, commemorating the 50th anniversary of another inspirational engagement of the Second World War, the attack by RAF mosquitoes on an ammunition depot in a Norwegian fjord. Arms from Beethoven's Fifth Symphony takes us to the Chant des Partisans, reminding us that there was another Allied army waiting for a signal to begin their engagement, the members of the resistance, with plans already laid, waiting to attack supply and transport lines in occupied France. Marches away. I'm reminded of that line in the Marseillaise, which is apposite to these events this week. It says, while peace and liberty lie bleeding, to arms. March Division Leclerc gives way now to fans from Canada. The band is the Canada Remembers Band, specially put together from various units of the Canadian Armed Forces to attend the event of commemoration this summer. Le Canada se souvient. They march on to Saint Senior Song, composed by Bobby Gimby. Gun Major Warrant Officer Martin Huppé, hands control now to the Director of Musen, Captain Alan Pineo. That was Saint Laurent, composed by the Canadian ex-serviceman. You will see from the uniforms that the bulk of this band is taken from the Royal Canadian Artillery Band. Thank you. contrasting strains of Mon Ami and Rule Britannia lead us now to Canada Overseas. Musical excellence of Le Canada se souvient, much appreciated by their audience here at Whale Island. Preparing to entertain us, the band of the United States Air Forces in Europe. band of the United States Air Forces in Europe begin their program with National Emblem. They're led by Drum Major Senior Airman Andy Cleaver and conducted by Lieutenant Colonel Roger Sebi. And now a Yankee Doodle signals a change of pace as the band prepares to get us, yes, in the mood. Staff Sergeant Kathy Henson and Master Sergeant Burdette Bex almost getting the crowd here at Whale Island on their feet. And you'll want to know that the trumpet soloist was Technical Sergeant Pete Pitkaitis. That certainly went down well with our honoured guests in the Royal Box, particularly Her Royal Highness the Princess Royal and her husband, who were clapping along. Stars and Stripes Forever, composed by John Philip Sousa, of course, former bandmaster of the United States Marine Corps. They march away to the United States Air Force song. Waiting in the wings now, the band of Her Majesty's Royal Marines, who prepare to march on to soldier and sailor too. Queen's Colour Squadron, Royal Air Force. They march on to The Longest Day, the theme of Gerald F. Zanuck's Normandy landings, composed by Paul Anka, to accompany soldiers Wayne, Mitchum, Fonda, and Anka himself. Aldo reminds us we're about to see a display of the most exquisite parade ground drill. Each man has to memorize up to 350 separate movements. And the whole display will be done without a single word of command. You'll have recognised the themes from The Great Escape and A Bridge Too Far. And of course it won't surprise you, having seen that impeccable display of drill, that the Queen's Colour Squadron held the world record for drill movements. A record standing at 2,001,384 rifle movements, 721,278 foot movements, all completed in 23 hours and 55 minutes. The Queen's Colour Squadron is, of course, part of the RAF Regiment. Their march is Holyrood, composed by Kenneth Alford, one of the very finest producers of military music, who retired just before D-Day. And we begin the first part of the retreat ceremony itself. The drum is, of course, the oldest of the military instruments. This drum display is the modern version of what would have been the call to safety from the garrison battlements. This bore from the ship by the quayside. This is the drum display Sea Soldier, written by Corporal Phil Masefield. And as the rain returns, the band takes up the strain of World in Union, based on the composition by Gustav Holst. the band of the Royal Marines quicken their pace. The quick march, The Corvetteer, composed by Corporal Matthew Dennison, whose lead violin in the Royal Yacht Orchestra. Lieutenant Colonel John Ware, Principal Director of Music, Royal Marines, will now conduct the massed band's finale of our beat retreat programme.
Symbolism of the embarkation of the invasion forces those 50 years ago. Let us now bring back into the arena each of
the bands will now march on to Hands Across the Sea. Joining us in the arena, the Royal Navy Mast Manning team. You can see the rain sheeting down, the wind picking up again, all of which will make it so much more difficult for the event we're about to see. To the strains of Westering Home, with its echoes of ships in heavy seas making for the security of their home port, crews battling with an acre of straining canvas, we begin the mast manning. They begin the long climb, this mast 97 feet high. This team from HMS Daedalus, the Fleet Air Arm establishment at Leon Solent, who revived the tradition of the mast manning in 1988. This is the lad to watch out for, the button boy. He's the one who will go right to the button, to the very top of the mast. Background, the channel ferries and the cranes of the dockyard, but way across the docks at Portsmouth, there is a reminder of the days when all this was done for real. We see through the haze the rigging of HMS Victory. Fearsome enough on a parade ground on Whale Island. Imagine being there on a ship rolling in heavy seas. Rule Britannia now, the signal to run out the flags. The first part of our manoeuvre complete. Follows the descent to the theme from Superman. Thank you. and preparing for the most fearsome descent of all. 19-year-old air engineer mechanic Dougie Gorman. He's 19 today. And he will slide from that point 97 feet up to the arena floor. Well done, particularly well done with the wind and the rain in his face. Dougie Gorman now runs forward to the royal box. As he goes, remember that in real life, that particular routine would have been done when ships were entering or leaving harbour, saluting passing dignitaries. The salute on this occasion is from Her Royal Highness to young Dougie. Grand Duke of Luxembourg and the Canadian Prime Minister looking on. Her Majesty obviously is impressed by that display of skill at high level, as we were. And the proud young Dougie Gorman runs back to join the squad. A squad that's made up from junior ratings from most branches of the Royal Navy. A squad superbly organised under the command of Lieutenant John Pantelli. We come therefore to sunset the heart of the ceremony in which we beat retreat. Sunset and the evening hymn. White ensign lowered as we await the evening hymn. Be still, my soul, taken from Finlandia by Sibelius. Lieutenant Colonel Ware takes the salute.
Lieutenant Colonel John Ware, Royal Marine.
Our party of royal guests and politicians will begin to make their way from the royal box. Lord Callaghan in the background there. Her Majesty and Prime Minister Major taking their farewells. Perhaps in an age notoriously short of heroes and racked with cynicism, we should be thankful that we can still keep contact across the decades with men and women who made their own sacrifice and gave us the luxury on an evening like this, a little space for cynicism. On the parade ground under this royal standard, perhaps the most important of our guests have been the veterans themselves, who've been roughing it around the square here at Whale Island. When you talk to them, you get the overwhelming impression of self-effacing men, shy to talk about their past in the events of 50 years ago. They remember comrades lost, they remember injuries seen at first hand on beach or battlefield. But when it comes to their own achievement, you get a shrug of the shoulders. This evening, our thoughts march back across the years to be with those assembled forces who knew that their great endeavour was about to begin. Thoughts of home and family crowding in as the light faded. And that strangely powerful combination of nervousness and boredom and expectation that ran its course that evening in 1944. With a new dawn would come the day when at last the troops who had waited for so many nervous weeks would be committed to their European journey. Tomorrow morning, before the Naval War Memorial on South Sea Common, there will be a drumhead service, a memory of moments of worship held on innumerable battlefields down the centuries. This national service of commemoration, thanksgiving and rededication will be led by the Archbishop of Canterbury. Some 75,000 veterans and their families are expected to attend, and we will be joining them.
Well, 50 years ago today, General Eisenhower was looking out of his window at Southwark House and saw what we're seeing now, heavy rain, clouds and wind. Times may change, but weather patterns for early June, it seems, don't. We can only hope that all will be set fair for that service here tomorrow morning. Afterwards, there'll be a seaborne ceremony marking the embarkation of what Eisenhower called the Great Crusade. The commentator is Julian Tutt.
The scene in Southampton Water, where two great passenger liners are already docked, ready to transport thousands of D-Day veterans on a voyage of rediscovery. The flagship of the old Peninsula and Oriental Steam Navigation Company, the Canberra, chartered by the Royal British Legion for British veterans of the longest day. And Cunard's flagship, the QE2, recently arrived across the Atlantic with many more American veterans, many of whom would have come to this country in preparation for Overlord on Cunard's previous two queens, the Queen Mary and the Queen Elizabeth. They've been greeted by Flaming June at its least flaming. The US Coast Guard cutter Dallas entered the Portsmouth Naval Base yesterday in a 4-7 gale, grateful no doubt for the shelter of the harbour. Tomorrow she'll be joining a commemorative flotilla at Spithead, where the world's largest warship, USS George Washington, is already at anchor. This massive aircraft carrier will be President Clinton's base for the next few days. Before crossing the Atlantic, the US Navy's largest and newest warship was put through her operational paces. She was christened in July 1990 by President George Bush, who had been a Navy pilot during the Second World War, serving on the San Jacinto, a ship he reckoned that had a deck not much wider than the wingspan of the plane he flew. He also wondered whether the San Jacinto wouldn't actually fit complete onto the deck of the Washington. The 100,000-ton Washington is propelled by two nuclear reactors, has a top speed in excess of 30 knots, and from keel to mast is as high as a 24-storey building. There are a wide variety of aircraft to suit a range of military roles, from fleet protection to retaliatory attack. From her 10 squadrons of planes, she can launch and recover these aircraft rapidly and simultaneously from her 4.5 acres of flight deck. The man in charge is Captain Robert Sprigg.
When we're fully loaded for deployment, we have about 6,000 people on board, about 80 airplanes, and we're basically an all-up city, everything from a propulsion plant to distilling units to feeding 20,000 meals a day.
Quality as well as quantity is required from the galley. In addition to the crew, President Clinton's party will be dining on board during the commemoration. The ship carries up to 3 million gallons of aviation fuel, and she's designed to take part in extended engagements. Numerous maintenance and repair shops are provided to keep her 85 aircraft ready for round-the-clock action. This number of planes requires considerable hangar space and a sophisticated flight control operation.
First aircraft, 101, 2 miles. Second aircraft, 506, 4 miles. Third aircraft, 621, 6 miles, in a hook at 8 with 300.
A massively impressive ship as she is on operation. And as she is today, anchored in the Solent, with her crew making ready for the arrival of President Clinton. Tomorrow, he, along with 11 other heads of state of the nations involved in Overlord, will be a guest of Her Majesty the Queen aboard the Royal Yacht Britannia, as they review a unique flotilla of warships and merchantmen representing all the countries and navies that have made up the biggest ever amphibious assault. Hopefully the weather will have remembered it's June by tomorrow.
And tomorrow, back here in Normandy, and here on this field, to the left of the Allied flank, a commemorative airdrop, again, weather permitting, will mark the first crucial and successful military operation in the landing. So that will be attended by the Prince of Wales. And then, of course, the Mulberry Harbour here at Arromanches, we're really being buffeted around by the wind, a reminder that military success came not only from courage and sacrifice on the beaches, but from a massive supply effort thereafter. So, the greatest armada ever assembled was set for the invasion. Eisenhower described it as a great coiled spring, coiled for the moment when its energy would be released and it would vault the English Channel in the greatest amphibious assault ever attempted. For the moment, from Portsmouth and Normandy, good evening.